Hello, my name is Adam Steen, and today we're going to go through an introduction to welding. First off, one thing you need to remember is that what you're going to be doing is joining two metals, and it will be very, very hot. Safety is the number one priority for us teaching this class. When you come out of here, we want you to leave with at least 10 fingers and 10 toes, preferably. Some of the safety precautions we're going to go through. First off, make sure you have long sleeves. When you're welding, you have spatter. When it gets hot, it sticks to your skin, and it will not be good. Secondly, you're going to have welding gloves. Every time you go in the welding lab, make sure you check out welding gloves. They dissipate the heat so you don't burn your hands, and it's a lot easier to work with when you're welding. Also, eye protection. Not only do we have welding helmets, but we also have safety glasses. When you're welding, spark will come over the helmet and back, bounce off the inside of the helmet and actually hit your eyes. It's happened to me, it's happened to lots of guys that have welded. Just make sure you always have safety glasses when you're in the welding lab. Also, make sure you have a hat. I have as much hair as I'm going to have right now, and I want to keep it. It's very important to make sure you have a hat because the weld spatter comes back and it'll roll down the back of your shirt. So if you see guys welding and they have their hat on backwards, that is why. That way it'll roll down the back of your shirt, but roll down the outside of your shirt. And finally, we're going to look at shoes. Make sure that you have leather shoes, not rubber shoes, soled shoes. The metal will be hot, and it will burn right through your very nice dress shoes. And sandals are not a good idea. Make sure you have at least leather shoes, or even leather boots would be the best when you're welding. Today we're going to go through a couple different types of welding. First is going to be gas metal arc welding. You're fusing two metals together due to simply an electric current. You're going to be funneling close to 240 volts through a piece of metal, heating them up, and putting a filler rod in. And that filler rod will be continuously fed into the material that you're welding to. Let's go through a couple different types of welding. Fusion welding is a nice way to look at joining the two metals. You're going to use oxygen, fueled gas. Also, there's gas tungsten arc welding, plasma arc welding, electron beam arc welding. There's all kinds of different welding, but we're going to focus on MIG welding today, which is simply wire feed welding. Let's look at the heat affected zone. First, you need to know what you're going to do and what to look for when you're welding two materials. If you look at slide 10, you'll notice that you have your weld metal, your heat affected zone, and then the base material. In order to make sure you have a good weld and have good penetration, you want to have an extremely deep penetration heat affected zone. That means you have a solid weld and that you're able to join the two materials together and make them almost as if they were the same material. And that's the whole point of welding. Consumable electrode arc welding is the nice long term for MIG welding. First off, we'll look at stick welding, which has the gas actually around the rod as you're putting it into the material. So if you look at slide 12, there's shield metal arc welding, which is simply a lot of guys call stick welding. You've got your electrode, and around that electrode sheath, there is actually a physical gas that's in a solid state on the metal. And when you complete the circuits, you have it grounded, and you complete the circuit, you're going to create an arc. And that arc will be shielded when that gas burns. That way you don't have porosity in your welds. A lot of times what weakens welds is when you have air or oxygen in your weld. So if it's the summertime and you're trying to weld and it's hot as can be, you simply can't turn the fan on because what that does is that gets oxygen into the weld and it creates air bubbles. And those air bubbles are what makes your weld weak. Slide 13 is what we're going to do mainly here in this section. We're going to look at gas metal arc welding. So if you look at the slide, you've got a shield. And around that shield, there's going to be gas flowing right inside the tube. Also inside that is going to be your electrode, your consumable electrode. The electrode is going to be continuously fed as long as you're pulling that trigger. And in order to pull that trigger, all you got to do is grab the gun. And when you're pulling that trigger, you're going to have gas and wire coming into your weld. And the whole point is to completely get oxygen out of the way and complete your circuit at that point, and that's where you're going to be welding. We'll also look at a couple different kinds of gas metal arc welding. The positive sides to gas metal arc welding are you've got a high deposition rate, which means you're going to be able to deform the material and lay down a bead a lot quicker than you would with shield metal arc welding. Also gets rid of the smoke and the fumes. If you go into a factory that is not using gas metal arc welding, you will be able to tell because there will be a huge cloud of smoke in the air. So a lot of times, gas metal arc welding decreases the amount of smoke because you're not burning the gas. The gas is already in its gaseous state, and it's completely shielding the weld as you're welding. And also, there's some limitations to gas metal arc welding. Obviously, you're going to have a gun, and that gun will be in your hand, and you can't really move it or twist it like you could with shield metal arc welding, where you can actually bend the rod and bend around corners. So your limitations are welding upside down. It can be done, but it's very limited and takes a lot of time to practice. Maybe we'll get to that later, I don't know. And also, when you have your welder a long distance away from where you're going to be welding, you can't actually run your electrode that long distance because it'll bind up in the cape and the cord. A couple different kinds of transfer. We'll look at spray transfer and globular transfer. So when you're welding, especially with gas metal arc welding, gravity is going to be on your side. So a lot of times with gas metal arc welding, you'll be welding down in a vertical position. That is the optimum way we can weld. And we set up welders at different companies, and all their robotic welders, they have positioners so that they can position their model or whatever part they're welding in a horizontal plane. So spray transfer is when you're going to have little droplets. If you look at slide 17, you'll see there's little droplets coming very quickly. So the wire is going to be feeding at a higher rate, and you're going to be heating up the material. So you're going to have a lot of droplets in a short amount of time, which will give you an even spread of penetration, but not as deep as globular transfer. If you look at globular transfer, you're going to lower your current and also lower your feed rate. That way, when you're welding, you will have large bits of your electrode being consumed and heated and then dropped into the heat affected zone where you're trying to weld. The whole point of that is to get deeper penetration. So if you turn your voltage down and your wire feed down, you'll go a lot slower. So you'll be able to heat up the two materials if you're welding thicker materials, and you'll be able to heat them up to a higher temperature and fuse them together with much more material than you would if you're simply using spray transfer. A lot of times spray transfer is on material that's a lot smaller than a quarter inch. That way you can move quickly enough and not burn through the material. If you look at slide 20, this will give you kind of an idea of what we're looking at. First off, you have shield metal arc welding, and you look at the electrode. It's a very large electrode, and it's got that gas coating around it. And then you go to flux core, which we didn't talk about, and you look down to gas metal arc welding, and your electrode is extremely small. Some benefits are simply to give you that flexibility to be able to spray or globular transfer, not just have a huge amount of material being laid down as if it were shield metal arc welding. The electrode coatings, like I said earlier, it just stabilizes the arc. It gives you ability to get rid of the oxygen so you have a clean weld and are able to lay down an excellent amount of material, just like you're fusing two metals without being able to tell the difference between them. And also, when you're adding different alloys, you can literally make a new material when you're welding them together, because you can combine the two different materials, your electrode and the material, your base material, and you can actually create an alloy depending on what kind of a weld you need. Just so you guys have a little bit of reference in other types of welding, we can look at non-consumable electrodes, which is what we call TIG welding, tungsten arc welding. You look at slide 23, and you can see the difference is you're going to have an electrode that you're actually physically going to be able to add to your weld. So the whole point is not only being able to heat up the heat affected zone by creating a current, but you're going to have your shielding gas, which is coming out of your gun, and then you're going to be able to control the amount of electrode or filler material that you're putting into your weld. So the whole point is going to be you can heat a small, small area and be able to apply whatever type of filler you want. Even if you don't need some filler, you'll be able to determine and make a lot cleaner and smoother weld. Look at slide 25. That is an excellent weld. You're going to have constant rate of speed. That's another big issue when you're welding is you need to have a consistent rate of speed. So you need to find a comfortable position that you're going to be in for a decent amount of time and get very comfortable with how your hand moves with the gun. And again, you can talk about it all day, but until we actually get in the shop and weld, it's going to be hard for me to explain what you're doing. So thank you very much for your time, and I hope you guys have a great time in our seminar.